And we are ready to start. Hi, everyone. My name is MikhailVink. Thank you for joining me for this almost the last session for the DrupalCon. I'm really happy to see the entire room here. So my name is Michael, or Mikhail, natively, and I'm working for Jetbrains for PhpStorm team as a product marketing manager. But don't expect any kind of marketing or sales pitch out of that, because I was a PHP developer for more than 5 years before that. And actually, everyone in JetBrains is a developer, so I still develop on the everyday basis on PHP to prepare different demos and stuff like that. So we will have here a hands-on session, and let's just begin with that. You can find me on Twitter, Mikhail. _Wink, if you want to ask any questions, so just we will get back to those after this short talk. It's going to be for half an hour or something like that. So for those who don't know, how many of you actually use PHPStorm? Oh, that's good. That's good. So I don't need to actually explain what is PHPStorm. So it's a PHP IDE with a lot of intelligent features and so on and so on, full-fledged. It has really advanced support for Drupal. So that's actually what we are all about here. So we will stop on this part for today. And actually, a couple of years ago, when we first thought about supporting specifically Drupal development and Drupal developers to make your life easier, we try to understand what problems can we solve. And with Drupal support introduced about half year ago in PHPStorm 7 and advanced in PHPStorm 8, we actually tried to solve some of those. So let's go straight to them. So first thing is that actually when you get a new tool, an IDE on an editor, there will be definitely some kind of learning curve, and you need to invest some time in order to get everything configured, all the coding standards, experience some problems maybe with configuration, and we tried to make it really easy. So let's switch to the IDE and actually see what we can do in order to get IDE configured really easily when you create a new plugin. So the first thing, you got a new tool and you would like to set up a project. So we go to a new project, and we're working on Drupal module, for example. So we make it Drupal module tester one or something. And we need to select a project type, and that would be Drupal module, so that everything will be pre-configured for us. We need to provide only a few things for that. That would be actually the path of your Drupal installation. That's Drupal 8 beta in my case. But in fact, that works pretty well in the same way for Drupal 6 and 7. So all the current and legacy versions are supported as well. So we choose that. We set a version number, and we click OK, and create a project in new window. And it actually offers us to set Drupal style formatting coding standard straight away, so that it will open it for us and highlight changes between default and Drupal coding standards. So we just can apply that, and we can also detect PSR0 namespaces automatically, and we have some more stuff here. So as we see on the screen, include paths, all the libraries from the Drupal core has been automatically included, so that if we go in settings and we go to PHP, we see that all the core libraries are here and all the modules also here, so we get all the Drupal API completion. And in fact, if you have for an existing project and if you would like to enable Drupal support there, you just need to go to settings, Drupal, and enable Drupal integration here. And if you have any changes in code style, for example, that also can be set from Drupal or PSR 1 and 2, for example, if you are working with Symfony components. So that's really neat. And all the coding standards will be applied when you reformat your code in the IDE, for example, before commit or something like that, which actually contributes to the quality of your code significantly. And apart from that, creating a new plugin, we actually get a skeleton, a basic skeleton for the plugin. Here, in case of Drupal 8, that's actually a YAML file. In case of Drupal 6, 7, it's info file, and you have a completion here for like some stuff. Like core and description, and everything is highlighted, so it's really easy to get it here. And all the external libraries are also here as well. But getting to more details, for example, we will open a node module. It's more advanced module just from Drupal 8. And the next struggle after the configuration actually we experienced with Drupal is hooks, because hooks are not real function, in fact, technically in Drupal, and that's a function you can't easily complete or navigate from or to in any kind of editors. You need a special support from that because they're not recognized by any tool, and there are really hundreds of them, so we need to invest some time in order to learn them. But in fact, what we came up with is completion for all the hooks in Drupal core and all Drupal modules, so that when you implement a hook in your new module, you just begin writing a name of your module, node in my case, and it will autocomplete all the hooks which it could scan from entire installation. And if you put some additional module, it will also get scanned, and it will be like really easy to get all the hooks. And even documentation for hooks parsed from API PHP files, so that we can navigate from hook to hook and see quick documentation, and that's actually it. Yeah, we need this hook. We just press enter, and it gets implemented in our module with arguments. So we don't need to remember all the arguments as well, and we don't need to navigate the documentation every time we need to explore some new hook. So that's really neat thing. Works for all versions of Drupal as well. And if we in any way would like to navigate to standard hook definition, we can do it from the left gutter over there, so that we can see here first information about hook in our API PHP file, if there is any, and we can navigate from here straight to the place where this hook has been defined with all the standard structure, with full PHPDoc, and from here actually we can get to all hook implementation, so that we actually see what modules are implementing these hooks. And from our hook, we can also navigate to the invocation of this hook. And in this case, we don't need actually to go from one file to another in order to find information about what we are working with. And with Drupal being quite a large code base, we definitely need to explore what's going on in other modules and the core quite extensively. So yeah, and in order to help you even more with navigation to documentation, you can navigate to a specific page in the Drupal API documentation right from the editor. You just need to get any kind of API method here, and from the context menu, it will take you straight to the documentation in the Drupal API. So that's like for really fast navigation from here. Yeah, getting back on what we have else.
Excuse me, what version are you running?
It's number 8. Yeah, it's PhpStorm 8, and that's Drupal 8. In PhpStorm 7, there is support for Drupal 6 and 7. Yeah, but hook-specific stuff and documentation-specific stuff is pretty the same in all three versions of Drupal regarding some structure changes, of course. Yeah.
Can you just show the context link to debugger again on screen?
Which one?
The context link out to debugger that you just mentioned.
Yeah. So, yeah, we just here, searching Drupal API. So that's really fast and neat. Okay, one more thing. When you have your coding standard applied in the project, you actually need to understand either you violate that or not. And in order to understand that, there is a great coder project available on GitHub for Drupal and on drupal.org. And it actually a kind of rule set for PHP code sniffer, and PhpStorm has a great integration with code sniffer in general. So the only one thing we need to download PHP code sniffer either from with Composer or just straight from the repository, and then we need to copy a rule set to their to the code sniffer distribution. And getting back to PhpStorm, I'll just open entire installation of Drupal 8 for this one. We can go to settings and we can find PHP code sniffer to see how is it really easy to configure that, because you just provide a PHP code sniffer executable and a couple of settings. For example, we need to be sure that inspections run with code sniffer are Drupal specific. So we go to PHP, PhpStorm settings, inspection settings, and we need to enable code sniffer validation. And we have Drupal here and many other frameworks as well. So we apply that. Enter. Need some time to get it re-indexed. Let's try. Yeah, how is it going here? For some reason, it doesn't like my live coding at the presentation. But the issue would be that just a second. Let's try here. Maybe that will work smoothly. Sorry about that, but that happens. Yes, so we got information from a PHP code sniffer. So probably I just need to reload the project, or it's just scanning an entire Drupal code base for quite a long time. So here what we've got is information from Drupal checker for code style violation, and it actually tells us that there should be only one space before asterisk, not two. And if we implement any kind of hook here, so, for example, this one will say as missing function or doc command, and if we do any kind of function here, and make incorrect indentation, that will actually reindex it again and tells us that we have some more problems. Yeah. So in some places here, it will tell us information from PHP code sniffer. And switching to the next integration with the tool popular in Drupal, that's Drush. Drush is a command line tool, which is very useful to, I don't know, update your module, for example, or install a new module, or I don't know, migrate database, and many other command line functions are available in Drush. So what we have is actually neat integration with Drush, so that you can run it straight in the editor. And for that, we need to go to command line tools, and we need to configure Drush in the way that we provide a toolpath. We provide an alias for that, and show visibility, current project or global. And then from tools and run command, we actually can execute Drush straight from the editor right here with completion for different Drush commands here. So here we had like Drush version, and we actually can get any of those, and all of that will be applied to your project. It will be run in this content root where are you right now, and that will affect your Drupal project, which is really convenient in order to perform any kind of changes. So you don't need to switch to any kind of different command line tool. So that's actually the URL where you can get Drush, and you need to install this command line tool and then point PHPStorm to that, and that's it. And as all the previous stuff are available for all Drupal 6, 7, and 8, that's actually interesting thing that for Drupal 8, PHPStorm or any kind of professional IDE is inevitable in Drupal 8, which is actually right now in beta, and hopefully will be released soon. And a good news that in PHPStorm 8, a couple of weeks ago, we already supported Drupal 8, and we have a whole stack of features for Drupal 8 development. So that actually the first thing needed to do in PHPStorm 8 to get it enabled is installing a couple of plugins, which you can find in settings, plugins, here you can find Symfony 2 plugin, which has been developed by open source community, by the way, by great guy Daniel Espendiller, and the plugin has now more than 800,000 downloads or something. And that's the first one you need to install in order to get Drupal 8 or Symfony specific component support. And another one is Drupal Symfony 2 Bridge, which actually gets all their components from Symfony to Drupal, because the project model is a bit different. So there are like many differences in how they actually operate. And after that, as soon as the plugin is installed, you need to enable it in settings again, so that you have enabled Symfony 2 plugin for this project. Yeah, and talking about what you can do with support for Drupal 8 in PHPStorm 8. The first thing is definitely deep understanding of structure of both Drupal 8 and Symfony 2. So for Drupal, we already have seen that that's about all the hooks, that's about all the navigation features, documentation, all the core APIs and methods, functions, stuff like that. And for Symfony 2 as well, that works for all components, because there is a great Symfony support that works for all components, all the code completion, recognition, and resolve for paths and namespaces, stuff like that, completion, navigation, and type inference, and support for YAML files. And we know that in Drupal 8, most of configuration for modules and routing and services is done in YAML, actually, so that it's already supported. And Twig as a new default template engine for Drupal 8, and further, coming from Symfony as well. There is support for all the directives and support for navigation there as well. But let's get to some coding in order to understand how does it work actually. So first you actually see that all the standard hook navigations for Drupal I've been showing around a few minutes ago are here. They are a bit more complex right now because there are a lot of Symfony components, and the code is now more OP defined, and that means that its structure is much more difficult to understand at first, but you shouldn't be afraid of that, because we are actually trying hard to help you understand the structure for Symfony and Drupal and all the components tightened together. So yeah, navigation, that's quite easy, that's quite understandable. Let's get to something more advanced. For example, we can go to standard YAML files. This one is a definition and information about the module, a new module in Drupal 8. And here we have Drupal specific completion for YAML files. So you see that it's in 4.yaml file, and here it actually awaits you to provide you information about dependencies, version, core, some required other modules and stuff like that. So we actually can complete some statements, which is very handy. But going further about YAML files, for example, when I go to routing, which is actually a Symfony thing ported to Drupal with some changes, you can see that at some point that can actually be quite frightening, because when you see that at first, that's really hard to understand where you need to go and what is connected to the, to that, and you need to check many, many files to understand what are they doing, and for that, you need to just actually press Control or Control on Windows Linux or Command on Mac, and you will be just navigated to following some routing statements which are accessible in our Symfony components. So yeah, right here we, for example, navigated to settings form. And that works for routing, that works for service container as well, and even for arguments in service container, because that might be quite a difficult thing to understand as well at first, not if you don't know Symfony codebase very deeply, of course. So that with simple click with a command to Control, you can navigate between our files and understand what's actually going on in this class and this argument and stuff like that. So what else I wanted to tell you is actually support for Drupal's T function, which is, well, of course, one of the base methods from the Drupal API in all the versions. And it actually scans your project and it provides you some of the options it could find right in the T method, so that you can complete it here, and that will be like much faster than going around entire project and understanding what you actually need to put here. And for sure, all their other variables and all the rest, which is provided by the IDE, is completed here as well. And getting a new template engine in Drupal 8 is also quite a tricky thing, because you need to really switch to a new syntax, you need to switch to new connections between modules, and that might be quite a hard thing to do. So we try to ease this switch with many completion, navigation, and other goodies. So for example, getting back to our T function, for example, straight in the Twig file, we have all the filters defined in your code, so that you can apply these filters to any kind of Twig variable or anything else in Twig. So, for example, getting back to our favorite T function, we applied this filter T method to some string, and we actually recognized that it's T, and we got the completion for all the statements as well. So it's like really faster to do, and for example, if you would like to link from Twig file somewhere else, we have all the Twig forms and Twig templates. All of them are scanned, so that you see that in the completion, and you can navigate from here to YAML statement for this template, so that you see what's actually going on here. Yeah. So this one is really good one for Twig templates if you are not that familiar with the syntax enough. Yeah. So I think that switching a bit further from Drupal 8, while still have a bit of time, I'll switch to some productivity tips which I love to show. So the first one would be actually a very, very, very simple comment. That's double shift. So with double shift, we actually get a search everywhere control here, so we can type anything we want. So for example, we would like some Twig templates, so it will find us Twig templates, all classes for Twig-related stuff, and we can just open it. Or if you want to go to Symfony tool window, we can just press it here. Or if you would like to go to settings of PhpStorm, yeah, here we go. We just went to to settings from here, so that it's really fast thing to discover what do you have actually in your IDE. And one more thing for very fast discovery is a productivity guide, which is available in help productivity guide. And here you see all the statistics of what you actually use in the IDE. So that you see I don't use for example console lookup and move, or I don't use file structure pop-up. So you can see here some tips how you can enable that, and you can explore new features daily, so that you make sure that you use all of them, and you are becoming much more productive for development, developing for Drupal. And one more interesting thing coming with Drupal 8 is actually proper testing using PHPUnit, which is also integrated in the IDE, and which also right now implemented in Drupal 8, and there are quite many tests there already. So I definitely encourage you to write tests for your modules and for the core, so that you can get entire code base properly tested, which is a very good thing to do. But when you do so, you need to run it, and you need to understand that nothing is broken after this or that refactoring, for example. So that what we need to do is only provide a directory for unit tests bundled with Drupal 8, and we need to have PHPUnit file downloaded, for example, or get one from the composer. And after that, we actually can run all the tests bundled with Drupal 8 or written by your own on your own. So we have like 1,600 already, and it will go through all of them and make sure that all of them are passing, and you can really see how fast is that. And you have an UI right in the editor, so if one test is not passing, you just click and you just jump to source from here. So yeah, if this test wouldn't be passing, we just navigate to source, and we understand that there is something wrong here right at this line, so we need to actually fix that. Getting back to the presentation, I want to show you some useful resources. So the first one would be PhpStorm website. If you don't have it already, just download and try. There is a trial for 30 days without any limits, and there is Drupal 6, 7, 8, and 8 support there. You should definitely check out. And in order to do so, the entry point would be Drupal development using PhpStorm tutorial, which you can either Google or just get following this link. So the video will be available after the presentation, so that you can just get this one and go to the tutorial. And all the Drupal-related functionality is described there. And you can just follow the guide and learn a lot of Drupal-specific things. Yeah, and one more thing is a video tutorial directory at the PhpStorm website and on YouTube channel. We have for more than 2 hours of structured video tutorials and more than, I think, 10 hours of video in total, so that you can actually follow different workflows, debugging workflow, testing workflow, Drupal development or Symfony development workflow, so that it's really easy for you to get better and get more productive with your IDE. And one more thing is providing feedback for the session. I would be really glad to hear your feedback on that. And that's it for today. I would be really glad to answer all the questions. Yes. What kind of settings or actually using Drush? Yeah. So the first one, when we would like to get Drush in our project, we just go to settings, command line tool support, we hit plus, and we need to add a new Drush tool, because we need to associate your project with some kind of Drush installation. For example, I've been installing Drush from the composer, which is a very easy thing to do. And we make a visibility for project. It can be global as well. And we provide path to Drush. So that's, in my case, Drupal 8 beta, core, vendor, bin, Drush. Here we go. So now we have it duplicated, so I just remove one of them. So we are done here, and all the statements, there is a special XML file with statements for the Drush, so that we have it built in, and all the commands for Drush are predefined here, and they are parsed from their official documentation, so that it's up to date, and we try to update it with every version, so that this XML file is bundled, and because of this file, we get all the completion here. So in order to open command line tool console, we can go to tools and run command. And here we use it like a simple terminal. So we begin writing Drush and then something. What should we do? For example, Drush config. That should ask us something. Yeah. So it's running. And here we can provide an option right here, right in command line tool. This one would be quite a strange one, yeah, because it will try to open VI because of Drush, yeah.
Can you run the Drush command and then type it, put some thread or something else?
Put some?
Run a Drush command and then type it to something else, the thread or?
Yes. Yes. So the question is, can we run Drush and use and open our next to it something to grep or stuff like that? So yeah, we have command line tool, and we actually have a terminal which is built in, which is a bit different because command line tool is actually for predefined command line tools, so that we have all the completion for commands and stuff like that, and terminal. Is a simple terminal. In my case, that's macOS 6 terminal, so I just can do anything I would love to do. So any kind of commands. And there can be a few of them, in fact. You can open a few tabs of the terminal, so you can switch between them back and forth. Yeah? Sorry, I couldn't hear that. Yes, actually, you can customize patterns because there is this XML which can be opened from the settings. It's actually not kind of encrypted or something like that. So there is a documentation available on how we actually parse this XML, and you can add there some additional comments, and you can also add some patterns and all the rest. So you can just modify existing comments or create a new comment. That's definitely possible. Some more questions? Tests?
Yeah.
I have, do you have this core tests folder? So so there are two things to configure. The first one is configure PHPUnit, so that, you need to click this run configuration, edit configurations, and then there is an icon next to alternative configuration file, so that is configuration for PHPUnit, and you need to get PHPUnit from somewhere. I've been getting it from Composer, for example, so that or you can just there is a link, you can follow that, you download it to, for example, project structure, and you show a path to phpunit.var, and for Drupal, you also need to put a default bootstrap file, which is in tests folder. And next to it, I just provided a path to core test directory. And that's it. After that, it will show this tick in run configuration that it's configured, and that's OK. Some more questions? Okay, it seems, yeah. Thank you.